Let's have a nice welcome for Larry Scott.
Well, first I want to say thank you very much. I mean, I really appreciate you taking the time out of your festivities here to spend a few minutes with me and see if I might be able to share some things with you that will help you in your training and maybe perhaps even with you in your life. When you think of it, it really is a great compliment for people to come out and hope that they can learn something from you. And so I really do appreciate it. I want you to know how much I do. We want to talk about the Olympia Secrets for Building a Better Body. I'm going to give you a little bit of a preview of most of you here weren't even born when I won Olympia. I'm going to give you just a little a pictorial preview of taking it up to that point. And then from there, we'll launch into showing you why I think that some of the ideas that I have might be of benefit to you. I started out in a little kid in Pocatello, Idaho. I weighed, well, here you can see a picture of me. That's me on the right. In the seventh grade, I was huge, wasn't I? I weighed less than 100 pounds, and you could count my ribs right through my pecs. And I hated it. I just absolutely hated it. I wanted the women to love me, and when I walked around for them to go, oh, there he is. They didn't even know I existed, and I hated it. I just wanted to be loved and appreciated, looked up to, those kind of things. And then one day, something wonderful happened. One day, I discovered a Weider magazine. Believe me, this was 1965. I went to the dumps, and I found this muscle magazine and had a picture on the cover of somebody you'll recognize. Steve Reeves, man, he was my hero. I tell you, I had him pasted all over my ceiling, and I really looked up to him. And I had never seen a muscle magazine before, and I thought, oh man, look at that, oh man. And as I flipped the page over, inside it had a picture of George Payne, and it said, you too can have an arm like this in 30 days. I took that thing home, and I had an old tractor axle out there, and it was real thick. It was solid steel, and I tore that thing down, and I started doing those funny movements that it showed in that magazine. I started to get a pump, and I'd never had a pump before in my life. And I ran in the bathroom and locked the door so my sisters couldn't come and see me doing it. I'm in there flexing my arm in the mirror and said, and I went back out and grabbed that tractor axle and started pumping those exercises. I started getting a little bit bigger, and boy, I was hooked. It says, I was hooked. I started doing the exercises just like it said, and I started to grow. I saw some changes in my arms. All I was working was triceps. And here I was after 4 months, and man, look at me. I was massive. But I was thrilled. Boy, that was between junior and senior in high school. And I went back to high school, and you know, you go to school early, and you walk up and down the halls relaxed like this. And that's what I did. And the people started to say, hey, you were lifting weights or something. Oh, no, not me. But boy, I tell you, I can't tell you, when they noticed me, my self-esteem needed that so badly, my head grew faster than my body. I just started, this is incredible. And so I kept training. I was super excited, but I wanted more than just triceps. But there's nobody, I was living in Pocatello, Idaho. Anybody ever heard of that? Anyway, Pocatello, Idaho. And nobody knew anything about nutrition in Idaho. So I said, I got to get out of here, and I got to find a place where the people know about nutrition. So I headed for California. And not long after, I learned of Vince Gironda and the Iron Grower, and I graduated to his health club, and I started to learn all these little tricks from Vince. He knew a lot of things. I mean, he's way ahead of his time. He started telling me different ways of holding the weights and different ways of moving, and I started to make more progress. And I found that when I looked at these big guys I had to compete against, and when I used the exercises the way the magazine said, I just didn't make any progress. I had to find ways to do things that would work for a guy that was genetically average, or even less than average. And here I was after training with Vince for about a year. Really something, huh? Using all these little things, I learned to put aside one night a week to just experiment with the ideas that I got and that Vince gave me. And here, a year later, started getting a little bit bigger. And I gradually learned more, and I grew bigger. And I entered Mr. California, and to my total surprise, I won Mr. California. It was in 1960. Man, I thought I was so great. You can see the difference in the size of the physiques today and then. But then, I mean, 10 years from now, you're not putting these guys down because 10 years from now they're going to be bigger. I mean, they're big, and the guys then were as big as you could get. Not Mr. California, but anyway. So here I was 2 years later. I entered Mr. America, and it was a seven-year dream come true. I stopped in a little town called Brigham City, Utah, and the local newspaper came out and took shots. I'm right on my parents' front lawn. Man, I was standing there, the hero returning home. Gee, I tell you, it was so great for my ego. I felt so fantastic. It was just, it's just exactly what this little Pocatello kid needed. But anybody ever heard of Harold Poole? He was 20 years old. He won Mr. America. I mean, he was the rave of everybody. This guy's going to take your plow. And so I competed against him in the Mr. Universe, and they're right. He did. I lost to Harold Poole. It was really good for my humility. That's what it was, because I thought, I'm winning everything, man. I'll dust this guy off. And I didn't. He beat me. I thought, man, I got to learn. So I went home that night and started training for the next year of Mr. Universe. And so the next year after that, here it was. I won Mr. Universe in 1964. I was starting to get bigger, starting to carry some pretty good size of my guns and starting to impress the people. And I thought, I'd won Mr. America, won Mr. Universe. That's it, man. That's it. As high as you can go. And Joe Weider and I were buddies, and he said, Larry, everybody does Joe Weider. Larry, we're going to do something different. I said, what's that, Joe? He says, we're going to create a new contest. Only the Mr. Universes and Mr. Olympia can compete in it. I said, you are? He says, yes. I said, what are we going to call it? And he says, Mr. Olympia. And I says, you don't call it that. That's a beer. I'm a Mormon boy, you know, so, you know, Mormons don't drink beer. Anyway, he says, yeah, but think of the Olympia contest. We'll call it Mr. Olympia. I says, okay. So I was going to be able to compete against all of my heroes, all the guys that were up on my ceilings, Steve Reeves, Bill Pearl, all those guys that were just beyond belief. And also, I was going to have to compete against Harold Poole because he had beat me, and this is my chance to see if I could beat Harold Poole. So here we went the next year. I was excited. I was nervous because of just what I said. I knew I had to get bigger and still be cut. The question was, could I do it? Because I didn't have the wide shoulders like these guys had. I needed some size, some bigger size, so I could stand next to these guys and not shrink. What to do? Okay, now we're starting to get into this point where I wanted to start telling you. I'm going to tell you about some secrets that I've learned about ways to make better progress on a lot of different exercises. By the time the Olympia rolled around, I had pretty good size. My arms and my shoulders were growing in size, and I still had pretty good cuts in my back. And the next night, Brooklyn Academy of Music, you guys haven't heard of that. It's probably already torn down now. But anyway, slugged it out in the very first spontaneous pose. Down here is Larry on the left, and Chuck Sipes in the middle, and Sergio on the right. Chuck was eliminated, and there was the last three came down to Sergio, yours truly, and Harold Poole. And here we were standing waiting for them to decide, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, the winner, I couldn't believe it. He said, and the winner is, the first Mr. Olympia. And they put that dumb Imperial Margarine crown on my head. And I worked so hard to comb my hair so pretty, and Joe kept sticking that thing on my head, and I could keep hearing that sound in that Imperial Margarine commercial. And I said, take that thing off. Now it doesn't look too bad. Should have kept it on. The next year I repeated again, and I won Olympia in 66, and then I truly did retire. And then I started training others, and I had all these notes. I mean, all these notes that I kept track of as I was training, finding different ways to pack some meat on a narrow frame. And so here we are. You guys patiently listen for me to glorify myself as I told you about how great I am. Now let's help you. Let me share some of the training secrets I picked up along the way to the Olympia crown. Here's how I packed meat on my shoulders. It was called the dumbbell tri-series. Oh, man. Well, you know, one of the things I need to tell you, if you're going to build shoulders, stay away from barbells. Barbells will wipe out your shoulder. It takes a year to heal a shoulder. They're tough to heal. And when you push with a bar, you're pressing against the joint, and you pry against it, and you get bad shoulders, and man, you're in trouble. You walk around like this for months, and you finally say, over here, it doesn't feel quite as bad. And you start going, before long, it's sore again. And, oh, you go through that same cycle, and you think, I'm going to have to kill myself because I can't work out, and I can't do my favorite exercise. Same with bench press, real hard on your shoulders. I hear some of you nodding, or I see some of you nodding, and you know that whenever you work, when you wipe out your shoulders, that's tough. But if you use the dumbbells, because the dumbbells track the movement, because the shoulders are supposed to rotate around that joint like this, and dumbbells can do that. So when you're doing presses, you want to move your shoulders like this. And there's some other things you need to know. Let's go to the next slide so you can see what I say. Dumbbell presses. Look at the way the dumbbells are being held. When you're pressing, here's a dead giveaway. When you're pressing a dumbbell or anything, and you start to push your hand like that, the reason you do that is because when I put my hand down here, when you flex triceps, the thumb goes down. That means triceps are working. If I put my hand up here, it gets hard, your thumb goes up, that means you're working triceps. You don't want to work triceps. You're trying to work shoulders. So you keep your little finger high. The little finger stays high anytime you're doing presses. Shoulders love constant tension. You don't do the last third because that's triceps. You don't do the bottom third because that's traps. You do the middle portion right here. That's all shoulders. And they just love it. Oh, shoulders just go, ooh, more of that. Give me more of that. And so you do that right in the middle right there. And you love it too because you look in the mirror and think, oh, wow, look at how great I look. Because you get those big old cannonball caps, they call them. Oh, I love that. Especially where it goes, thunk, right inside here. Look in the mirror and everybody's like, oh, you hero, you. Oh, yeah, it's pretty nothing. Dumbbell presses. Another thing, when you bring it down, remember this. You're three times as strong on the negative as you are on the positive. You got all that power on the way down. So stick that thing out and really bring it down slow. Making sure that you don't stick it out so far that your thumbs change. The little fingers stay high and the thumbs stay low, and you bring it way down here, push it back up again about 3/4, 5/5, and slowly bring it down. Boy, you can feel it just sitting in your chair. You can feel the difference between like this, a big difference. If you want big deltoids so bad that your mother says, what are you doing in here? You don't live here. Yeah, that's me, Mom. That's what you want. You want to get so big your mom doesn't recognize you. And that's a good way to do it with your shoulders. And shoulders are the man's muscle. You could put a coat on a guy. That's why these big guys put all those stuffing inside their coats here so they look big. Okay, that's dumbbell press. Let's move on. Middle 3/5, dumbbells, not barbells. Side lateral raise. This is the hardest exercise to get right of any body part. You start off, you think you always do it in front of a mirror, and you do it with a tank top, and you look in the mirror, and you got to see your real deltoids flex in the mirror. If your real deltoids are flexing in the mirror, it means you're not up too much, and it means you got your elbows where they should be here, and you're working side and rear deltoids. Not frontal deltoids. You do it like this, you work frontal deltoids. Once you get frontal deltoids too strong, you're in trouble because they bully everything else. When you do bench press, frontal deltoids. When you do dips, frontal deltoids. You want side, the side and rear. That's what's the pretty part. And so you don't want to get this by doing these things. So you look in the mirror, tank top, and you got to see rear deltoids flex. Think in terms of the dumbbell handles being empty. And you fill them full of water, and you're just going to get up here, and you're going to dump a little bit of water out. Back down and cross them over here, one on top of them, not like this. One on top, and get a little momentum, drop on the top. Down, drop on the top. If you don't, you'll lift your traps. If you lift your traps, you want to lift elbows, not shoulders. If you lift shoulders, you build traps. Traps are a bully. Once you get big traps, you can't build deltoids. So you got to lift elbows, dump a little water, back down again. That's the hardest one to get right. Practice with a small weight. By the way, when we get done here, little commercial. We have a DVD at our booth, and it shows all these things in motion so you can see how these things are done. That's a hard exercise to get. Okay, one final last one. It says dump the water. How are we doing on time? Man, I'm living. Bend over Delray's. This one's not too hard. Just think in terms of cross over in front, and let the little finger guide it. It's the little fingers. If you want to build big deltoids, you need to build grip because you got to control that dumbbell handle. Because that's where you get the beautiful deltoid. This is for gals as well as men. Okay, what's next? Important deltoid tips. When doing dumbbell presses, always keep the little finger side of the dumbbell higher than the thumb side. We already covered this, but it's just a review. When lowering the dumbbell, stick the dumbbell out as wide as you can without lowering the little finger side way out here, but still keep it like this. Press the elbows back as hard as you press them up. When you're pressing the elbows, press the elbows back, because then that builds rear deltoids and side deltoids, not just frontal. Is this making sense? Dump a little water out the top of the movement. You should see your rear deltoids flex in the mirror in front of you. Put your dumbbells, your rack over, and a mirror behind it, because you want to watch those rear deltoids. If you got those rear deltoids flexing, you're right on track. If you can't see rear deltoids, you're standing up too much. Deltoids love constant tension and down the rack. I don't know why. Every muscle group has got something it prefers, and deltoids love down the rack. 80s, 70s, 60s, so forth, no rest. And they love that constant tension. They don't want to lock out, and they don't want to sit here. They love that spot in there. And you will too, because you start doing it and think, ooh, man, I'm not telling anybody about this. This is too good. Deltoid burnout. Okay, after you do your tri-series, here's things that you can do, and I'll bet you nobody has ever seen this one. I stumbled on this about a month ago, and I'm not even going to tell you. I have to kill you first. You know, you heard that thing. Robbie Robinson lift. This isn't too unusual. After you do your tri-series, you just get heavy dumbbells. Let me show you. And all you do is just lift those hummers up as far as you can up here, just like that. Right in front of the rack. Use big iron and just lift those hummers. Line side del raises is a great finishing off movement. Steve Reeves used to do this a lot. Serge Nubray, ever heard that name? He used to love this with a lightweight. You just get here. Here's the way you do it. Watch the little finger on the top of the movement. See it's higher? See the rear deltoid flex, the side and rear? It's not like this, it's like this. You won't have near as much power that way because you're accustomed to using frontal deltoid. And you can find that wimpy little weight. People look at you and laugh, so you go back to the heavyweight again and do poor reps. Shoulder burnout exercise continued. Machine press. Oh, this is so fantastic. You'll love this. You get on a machine, press machine. With the bars going this way, never this way. That's frontal deltoid. It's always this way. And you sit here like this, face in, not face out. You face in the machine, put a belt around you because you don't have any back support. And you just sit here like this, and you throw that hummer up like that, and the elbows way back, and then bring them all the way down here and all the way back up. It's so great to finish off that tri-series for deltoids. That's another one of those. You can't keep your eyes off the mirror when you see it, how that blows up your outside deltoid. Here's a representation. The higher you make the seat, the more you can bring it down here, way down here. It's like a side lateral raise. And you bring it slowly back up like this and down again, just like that. Oh, I tell you, makes my mouth water to think of it. Rotate the elbows. Raise the seat so you can get lower. Now, here's the one I was telling you about. I know you have never thought of this. I'm such a dummy, I should have caught on to this. I always thought, maybe you're like me, I do supine barbell kickbacks. And I was doing it for triceps. That's what they're for, right? I do it for triceps. But my shoulders would give out. I'd say, oh, man, I can't do that because my shoulders get tired. I said, wait a minute. Duh. If your shoulders are getting tired, maybe you're working shoulders. Brainstorm. You know, if a guy as slow as me can figure this out, think of you. You're going to set new records. And so I started doing that thing, and oh, I'm telling you, and you do it with dumbbells, and I'm telling you, you won't want anyone to know what you're doing. Because you do that with dumbbells, you put the dumbbell where the face of the plate hits it on this side of your hand, like this, you lay back over, twist the dumbbells until they're twisted out, and you do those kickbacks, and I'm telling you, this is so great. So great. It's just fantastic. You have to try it. You got to try it. And unfortunately, I don't have a picture of that one. But the barbell is, I started for a month or so with a barbell, and I said, how would dumbbells be? I've tried with dumbbells. So I started with dumbbells, and it was even better. It's a monster. Okay. Is this making sense? How about for you ladies? You're saying, what am I doing here? These meatheads? I don't want to listen to these guys talk about building big dildos. Yeah, but we like their big dildos. Is making sense, Gretchen? Okay. Using these tips and tricks, even a genetically challenged person like myself can carry some good size. Here's a good example of it. Pretty good, huh? Even with the big guys today. That looks pretty good, doesn't it? I used to knock them dead on stage with that at the Olympia. They'd say, more, more. You know what I mean? Yeah, more. Try a series on Scott Preacher Bench. This is the best low bicep builder I've ever found. You know, when I was a little kid in the fifth grade, I used to sell papers, and I'd go down to the Idaho State Journal, and pick up my papers, and I walk over to a sporting goods shop, and they had a guy on this exerciser band, and he was sticking his arm on like that. You have this great, big, beautiful bicep. I said, kind of get that thing so the arm looks good sticking out. You could always flex it, but to stick it out and have it look good, says, that's it, man. Sticking out. Look good. So I started doing this, and Vince Gironda told me. He says, here's what you got to do, Larry. You may know Vince Gironda. It's horrible. Terrible. He had a personality bypass, but he really knew training. Cheat dumbbell curls. You start off, it's a tri-series. You do first dumbbells. It's on the preacher bench. I'm going to call it Scott preacher bench because if it's a flat face, it won't work. It's got to have that rounded face. It's got that rounded face and an offset post so you don't bang your groin into that post. You do that once or twice, you won't do it anymore. So the pelvis has got to be forward because when you do a hard dumbbell curl, you know, you want to go, ah, oh. So the post has got to be out of the way. So the normal ones with the post back there won't work. And it's got to be rounded. Okay, so you start off with, and you use dumbbells, heavy as you can go for 6 reps, and you can cheat all you want, but you got to go down, and you got to go down here and unwind your wrist. You can't do this stuff. Nobody wants to get down where it really is painful down here. You got to get down all the way through it, unwind your wrist, and wind it back up. And as it comes up, you can cheat up if you want to on this one. But in a minute, cheat is not allowed. You do 6 reps, 4 burns. You can see me all the way down. All the way down, unwound the wrist. Okay, the next one. Here's the key to growing on this tri-series. It's the barbell, and it's done super strict. You get your armpits way down on the bench, and you go all the way down. See if I can see the next exercise. You go all the way down, and once you're down there, you got to curl the wrist up. And you can't cheat at all. You can't even go like this. You got to just pull that up, and gradually you just hand it over to the biceps. Because you're going to do the first part with forearms, and you just hand it over to the biceps, and then the biceps take it. And they work right down there, right there. That's low bicep, right in that area. That's low bicep. If you want that really pretty part of the bicep, you got to make it work right down there. And you come up, and you really straight down. 6 reps, 4 burns. It feels like your arms have been beat with rubber hoses. It's big time pain. Big time pain. But boy, your arms, they grow. And then you finally finish off with the cheat easy reverse. That's just on the easy curl bar, reverse grip, and you're going to cheat on this also. So let's review real quick what that is. Important preacher bench building tips. Go all the way down and uncurl the wrist. Work on your forearm so you can curl the wrist, because when you do a preacher bench, you know where you fail? You don't fail here. You fail right here. You can't get it started. You build forearms so you can get it started, because once you get it started, your mechanical advantage is increases by the square of the distance, and so you got a lot more power. So you got to work forearms. I can see these girls just loving this. I said, boy, I've always wanted to work forearms. Find ways to do the barbell curl more strict. This is the key to the growth on the preacher bench. Elbows in, hands wide. Elbows are always in, hands wide. That's the key to working low biceps. Rest only long enough for your partner to do his series, and then you do yours again. Spider curls, the best peak bicep movement I've ever found. Ever heard? Everybody even heard of a spider curl? Here's one. They call it spider because it's got all those legs. But it's great for preacher. Great for peak. Look at it, I'll show you an example. Here's a Scott preacher bench for low bicep. You can see the low bicep towards the elbow. That's just preacher bench. Okay, now switching off of that and going over and using the spider for a while, here's what you see. Spider for just peak. Look at the difference. See the difference in the peak on the two? Spider is a... And if you're using a preacher bench, use the vertical side for peak. It's not as good as a spider, but it's better than the rounded side for peak. That's what you get, the difference between, because you want to get a low and you want to get that beautiful peak. Okay? Building all three heads of the tricep. Oh, this is, I'm going to show off here. I thought this was a great shot. I think Mike Nephew took this shot of me, and I thought, oh, man, that looks so great. What happened? I lost it. Oh, shucks. No, it's coming later. That's right. Tricep. Man, I'm going to get through this. The biggest part of the tricep is the long head. And this head doesn't even work. Everybody does this. That doesn't even work. The only way you build a long head is you've got to get the elbows way up over your head, because the long head is connected to the back of the shoulder. And you don't even get enough pre-stretch unless you get it way up over here. When you're down here, the long head doesn't do it. It's external and internal. So if you want that big long sweep underneath like the bicep sticks up, you've got to get down like this on your knees and get those elbows way up behind your head, and it gives you a real big long sweep. I'll show you a picture in a minute, an illustration of it. The external head, any kind of movement that does extensions, like this, these movements all build external head. And then to get all three heads, you do a movement like a close grip bench press. Builds all three heads. Okay, now I think this is a good shot. No, it isn't either yet, not yet. To build the long head, these are just the tips. The elbows must be above the head, complete stretch, the V-tricep bar, 2 inches thick. I can't go into that now. External head, any lockout movement, and finally, all three heads, big weight, close grip bench press. That gets all three heads of the bench, of the tricep. Okay, there's that shot. Preacher bench, spider bench, tricep, and forearm bench combined, and it gives you arms like that. See right here? But you can't even see it. I can't either. See that little bump on the forearm? That comes from using a forearm bench, and so you can get your wrist curled, because you've got to be able to get your wrist curled, or you can't build huge biceps. How to get rid of pot belly without doing sit-ups and leg raises. Midsection is red muscle fiber. It's not white muscle fiber. You take a duck breast is red muscle fiber. You take a duck and throw it up in the air, land in Alaska. You take a chicken, white muscle fiber, throw it up in the air and land on your head. This is red muscle fiber. And it says, when you give it red, white muscle fiber exercise, it goes, give me a break. I could do that all day long. I'm red muscle fiber. I'm Alaska bound. And you're doing sit-ups and you're going, that's all I can stand of those things. I don't want to look any better than that. But when you learn to work red muscle fiber with a kind of exercise that red muscle fiber wants, your waist just goes, boom. And you know what the area you want more than any else? Is right down here, between the navel and the pubic bone. I used to work out all the time. I did sit-ups and leg raises, and my wife used to say, how come you got that little pooch down there and you work out all the time? Well, first thing I wanted was a divorce. And second was, I wanted to find out how to work those stinking lower abs, the pot belly. We put an ad in the paper. The most interest-getting ad we ever run is how to get rid of your pot belly. Because after a person turns 30, gravity pulls down on their internal organs, pushes out against those lower abs. They start to stick out, and it starts to push down on your pelvis, and it goes down, and the back goes up, and you get too much curve in your low back, and you got that belly, and you got to decide, should I wear my belt above or below my waistline? Too many go below. But if you just learn to do this strange exercise, you got to do all by yourself because it's embarrassing. So when you got to pull the pelvis up, makes you look like you're just doing kind of like a love thrust. But you got to just pull that hummer up. And the only muscle that can pull that pelvis up is the very one that's pooching out. And so once you learn to do that, it pulls that thing tight. And the wonderful thing about red muscle fiber is when it relaxes, it doesn't just pooch out all the way. It relaxes a little tighter than before. And before long, it relaxes like this. So after I start doing this movement, I get up in the morning, I touch my stomach. It's flat, man. I ask a woman, Why do women want flat muff? Why do they want to get rid of their pot belly? I know why men do, because it makes them look virile. You don't want to look virile, do you? She says, no, but it's sexy. And I guess it is. After you reach a certain age, if you're flat through the midsection, it looks good on man or woman. And you got to learn to put that thing into cramp. Now, I don't have enough time to go into that, but I do have a video of it. No, I don't either. I have to tell you a little bit about it. If you want to learn more about it, come by my booth, and I'll tell you more about that ring of fire. Without doing sit-ups and leg raises, they go on forever. Here you can see all he's trying to do here. Paul is just trying to show you how to make that thing go into cramp. And the key is lift, squeeze, burst. Make it go into cramp. When it goes into cramp, you stretch it out and you move to the next one. It's lift the hip, squeeze, and burst. And it goes into cramp, you stretch it out. And your waist is going to go just like mine did. I learned this ring of fire, and my waist went down to what it was in high school. And I was like 60. So it was a fantastic way to do it. And I was thick. My waist had gone up to about 34, 36. So you can see all he's doing is just, he's recruiting muscle fibers by sitting down here and holding that, and it starts to fire all those muscles. Here you can see him here do it again. Here he's working on the intercostals. He's just learning to move the hip. Just lift the hip, squeeze down, and make it go into cramp, and stretch it out. Go to the next one. Got 9 muscle groups around the midsection. Upper lower abdominals, intercostals, oblique, quadratus, spinal erectors, and on around. And everybody wants a firm, hard midsection, and you can get it in just a few minutes a day doing that ring of fire, we call it. It has to go into cramp. The muscle has to go into cramp. That red muscle fiber cannot ignore that. When it goes into cramp, it sends an alarm signal, clang, 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 to the pituitary gland. It says, send me growth hormone. The guy's going crazy. And it starts pumping growth hormone, and growth hormone does 3 things. Burns fat, builds muscle, makes you look and feel younger. So you want all the growth hormone. When you were a teenager, your body was pumping it out like crazy. You could do anything. You could eat. You could abuse your body. You still look good. Then about age 30, everything began to change. It stopped releasing as much growth hormone. But the pituitary, when they examine the pituitary gland of 80-year-old cadavers, they are full of growth hormone. It's just a matter of getting your body to release it. And that's one of the ways you do it, is by getting the muscles to go into cramp, especially red muscle fiber. The secret is the lift. Lift, squeeze, burst. Important abdominal training tips. Midsection is red muscle fiber. It has to be trained different. You got to make it go into cramp. You can train midsection several times a day because it recuperates. White muscle fiber has to recuperate 72 hours. Red muscle fiber, you can do it in the morning, noon, night, and it recuperates easily. You can spot reduce if you spot train. Chest secrets. Mid-pecs. Okay, a lot of these thoughts here. Mid-pecs. Some of the things you want to know is, look at the way I got the hands again. The hands are like this. Again, if you're going to do presses, don't press like this. That's triceps. You want to work the chest. So the hands stay like this. And they come down here, and they stay in that position with the little fingers high. Just try that one time and see the difference in how you feel it, that works your pecs, rather than when going like this. It's a tremendous difference. It's the same concept as it was for deltoids. Upper pecs, here's one you probably never heard of. Use a Smith machine. Go over, set the bench, and have the bar come down right to your neck. And then throw the elbows forward, way up high, and press that thing with the elbows up high and watch what happens to your upper pecs. If you do an incline bench, dumbbell and press, nah, they're okay, but they're nothing great. You do that on the Smith machine a couple of sets and just look at what happens to your upper pecs in the mirror. They're magnificent. Really, it just does tremendous. Also, lower pecs, the best way to do that, it's the same concept. You get your elbows on the bench, on the parallel bars. It's better with V-bars. Throw your hands around backwards like this. Elbows forward, knees forward, and your back, not like this. If your back arches, that's triceps. Get your back over here like this. Elbows forward, that's all pecs. Pecs have to do every bit of it. Triceps can't help you at all. And it really builds pecs. I see a few people nodding like they've done this. It really works a lot better. Most people, when they do dips, they do it like this, and that's triceps. Okay, any chest-building tips? Mid-chest, hold the little fingers higher than the thumbs and press to the outside butt of the palms. And this places the stress on the pecs, not the tricep, and lock out on top. upper pecs, use a Smith machine with the elbows high and bar all the way down to the neck. And finally, lower pecs, use a V-shaped dipping bars with elbows forward, palms reversed. The best calf development I've ever used takes three guys. Well, if you want good calves, try this. Remember, calves separate the men from the boys. Because you got to put up with pain with calves. Because you know why? Red muscle fiber. They got a lot of endurance, and you got to kill them, make them grow. First thing you got to do is you got to go through a movement that they normally don't see. Because you're walking around doing one-legged half reps all day long like this. It sees that all the time. One-legged half reps all day long. So you get over there and you do this. They say, give me a break. They stay little scrawny, little calves. You think, I'll wear long pants. I won't wear shorts. I'll get bigger arms. People never look at my legs. But when you do, when you combine donkey calf raise with standing calf raise, you got a winner here. But what you got to do is you got to do them. Now here we're showing, oh shucks. Where's my guy? What you got to do with calves is you got to do them without shoes and without socks. Because you got to get a movement that the calf has not seen before. It sees this all the time with your full body weight. So you got to get a movement that is all the way down to where it's killing you, and all the way up to where you go to bone support. You know why? Because when you go to bone support, you get a fresh shot of blood. Not that old crummy blood with all that lactic acid in it, but you get up to the bone support and it relaxes the tension on the calf. You get fresh blood. You can go all the way back down again and all the way back up. But if you do that with socks on or shoes on, you can't get all the way up because you got your laces binding. But you take those off, your socks off, get rubber pant on that thing, hang on to that thing with your toes, and man, you can get some really moving. And you get two guys. One guy, thanks very much, Mike. You get two guys doing this, and then you alternate with the standing calf raise machine. See how high I'm getting? I got the shoes on, but you got to get up there. You got to get up to bone support. I got holes in my socks, so I'm going to turn so you can't see it. I saw that this morning. I said, I got a hole in that sock. Got to get out the darning needle. You have to be old to even know what that means. Used to be you darned your socks, you know. Anyway, here's what you're doing. You're getting like this. Boom. You got to get up to that bone support. There, I'm supported by bone. Here, I'm supported by muscle. But I want to get there, where my leg flips through. Then it gets a new, fresh shot of blood. I can go all the way back down again. Up there, I go all the way back down. Touch my heels on a 4-inch block. Touch my heels on a 4-inch block. Back up again. And you do 20 reps. Red muscle fiber, big time reps. Big time pain. And you do those three back and forth, just going around a circle, and you'll get some beautiful calves. It is painful, but it works. Calf building tips. It takes three guys to build great calves. You must get full extension and full contraction. Do the exercise with bare feet and rubber padded block. Bend over at the waist until your upper back is parallel with the floor. So you're resting your elbows on something, so your back is just parallel with the floor. That's a perfect stretch. Powerful forearms are the key to huge biceps. Here's some exercises for building forearms. This one's pretty good. And that one's pretty good. This one's better. Wherever it is. And here's the one that's a winner. You can rebuild some forearms with this movement. This is the best. You got to get a bench that is low enough that you're getting your hips lower than your forearms. And it's got to be just high enough so that when you pick it up, you can set it on that bench. And so that the plates don't hit the ground when you go all the way down. And that you can use a big iron. I bet I use more weight on my forearms than anybody here. I use 2 1/4. Anybody use that much? It's because I got that apparatus. If I tried to do it like you're doing off one of those long benches, or you're down here like this, you know, and the bar's hitting on the end of it here, and you think, well, I didn't want those anyway. But you get a bench that's just right. You can get your down and out and down here, and you can pick that thing up, man. I'm telling you, you can get a big iron. Then you get those forearms that you can do your forearm. You don't have that little weeping willow forearm, big biceps and no forearms. Then you got this and this, whole package. Fun, man. Fun. These women are saying, these guys are sick. They really are. What are we doing here? We're going to get contaminated. Okay, what else we got? Tips for building huge forearms. Hips got to be lower than the forearms. Not only that, but anytime you're doing a seated press, make sure your hips are lower than your knees. You got all that power. If you're sitting up here like this, then you push with your legs, and you get them down here, you can't use legs, and you get all that power right from the hips. Thumbs under the bar. If you see a picture of a guy doing forearms in a magazine saying, here's how I work my forearms, and he's got his thumb around the forearm, you know he's lying. Because nobody does forearm curls with a thumb over the bar. It's always under the, because the thumb is powerful. Use it to help you, not fight against you. Stay down. No, come on. Get it underneath, and it'll help you come up. Just makes sense, huh? Kind of dumb, huh? We should know that on our own. Get a bench you can get your knees around just high enough so you can lift the bar into position and not hit the ground when you extend your wrist. That's perfect. I think all I had to say at this point was we had a little bit of fun. That's nice. And hopefully you learned something. I've been doing this for 50 years. Last September, this was 50 years. I used to have a teacher that said, if you watch groundhogs for 40 years, you're going to learn something about groundhogs. And I've been watching groundhogs for 50 plus years. I'm the kind of guy that likes to dig into things, and I got to make that better. We should stack benches up on the edge and everything and find a way to make this better. And after I put that much energy into this for 50 years, it's a real compliment to me and very gratifying to have people that are really into the same thing say, hey, this guy, he's a kind of a dummy, but he knows a few things. I'm going to try this. I like that because it means all these things I've learned, your mind is saying, hey, because I can watch your faces. And you're saying, hey, he's got something there. I'm going to try that. And when you go and you do that, you can say, that was good. I'm going to buy all his stuff. No, but at least you're going to get something out of it. You're going to say, I'm learning something. And that's what I want. I want you to be able to learn something from this and take it home, because that's what I'm here for. If I die tomorrow, I want to feel like I put 50 years into something to helping people learn something in the very field where I work so hard. You know something? Just a final testimonial as I leave. It's a great honor and a real privilege to win Mr. Olympia and have kids come up to me and want my autograph and say, oh, you're needing everything. And say, yes, that's right. But that's enough about me. Let's talk about you. What do you think of me? You've all heard that before, haven't you? Haven't you? Well, now you know it. Anyway, but you know something? That isn't as neat. It really isn't. I tell you this from my heart as a brother to sister. And brother to brother. Shella's out here also. That isn't as neat as it is to know that I can stand here in front of you and talk to all of you like there was one person without any fright or any fear or anything, just to tell you how I feel and everything. I can feel, I don't know what religion you are, but I can feel my Father in Heaven supporting me and standing here and giving me the ability to share these things with you one-on-one, and you can feel it too. You can feel the goodness of it, that we're sharing something here, and we're really kind of sharing like brothers and sisters. Isn't that good? Thank you very much. I really appreciate you being here.
Thank you so much, Larry. Larry Scott, everybody. Let's give him a big round of applause.
Thank you.
We are joined by Mr. Larry Scott, the first Mr. Olympia. It's so nice to have you.
Nice to be here.
What brings you back time and time again to the Mr. Olympia?
Well, you go back to your roots, I guess. And it's nice to go back and see the guys that are competing, see the difference in the sizes that they are compared to when we were competing. And it's nice to see all your friends again.
Absolutely.
And make contacts and just get back into the same feeling that you had back years ago and you remember when you were young and the only thing you thought about was your competing and winning. And I guess like anybody that's competed, they like to go back and see their old friends. And they come back too, so we have a chance to just meet old friends and socialize.
Absolutely. Tell me what it was like at that first Mr. Olympia, winning the whole experience.
How much time do you have?
How much time are you? As much as it's going to take.
Well, it was a little different then. You're probably too young to know that. You are. But then they didn't have prejudging. The audience decided who was the winner. And so you really played to the audience. And the audience would applaud and and give the judges their I don't want to say that the judges didn't have to make up their own opinions, but when the audience response is a lot of the judging, then you really got a lot more enthusiasm from the audience than you do today. Because they kind of know that who's going to be the winner. By the time pre-judging's over, they figure it's already set. So by the time night comes, they're kind of tired, you know, and they're kind of... That's why some of the times you'll see guys look like this. Hey, man, where's... Come on. They never did that then. Never. I mean, the response was immense. You could not believe it. It was just like the roof was going to come off. It was really quite different in that regards.
And who'd you beat?
You won't even remember.
But I'm sure some of our viewers will.
Harold Poole, Sergio Olivier, Chuck Sipes. Those are ones they remember.
As it was the first Mr. Olympia, what, I mean, obviously now the guys know as a routine what the judges are looking for. In the first contest, what did you know that helped you get through up on that stage?
Well, now you have mandatory posing. We didn't have that then. We'd come out and we'd do our posing routine. And so, and you had your music, and you were really playing a lot more off of the audience, and the audience would respond to a certain pose, you'd do that again, and so when they called you back, you'd build a new routine around the poses that they really liked. And so when they called you back, you'd build a new routine around the poses they liked best of that. And so it really created a lot of enthusiasm and excitement that would be nice to see today. And then again, of course, we weren't posing at all for money then. It was, you were doing it just for the glory just to say you did it. And in a way, that kind of endears you more to the audience, too, because now they think, hey, he's making a lot of money, and it's nice that they can make a living now at it. There's no question about that. But whenever money enters the situation, it takes away as much as it gives. And when you knew they were doing, they were killing themselves for just that moment on stage and that moment of glory, you had a tendency to identify with it more and really want to pour your heart out for all the work they did for you. As a matter of fact, when you're doing that, you come back, you spend the whole year. When you left the year before, you come back and you say, all right, now I want to see how well all of my effort is going to pay off for the fans. See if they really like what I've done with the body they're cheering.
From the first Mr. Olympia to today, how have you seen the sport and these events change?
Well, obviously the size of the contestants is like, they've got to be 100 pounds heavier. Not quite, but no, they wouldn't be 100 pounds heavier. But they're much bigger, much, much bigger than they were before. We had a job besides our competing. We weren't paid to train. So you had to figure out some way to get your workouts in along with your normal job. Now they're paid to train, so they just spend the whole day figuring out new ways to train, better ways to improve their nutrition, and so they just have more of an opportunity to really make more of their potential. And therefore, not only that, but because there's more money now, then you get guys that come into this that have great potential. Whereas most of the fellows that I was competing against then, we were all little when we started. And so we just wanted to get big enough just to be average. And then we got bigger, you know, we said, whoa, man, this is really exciting. So most of the fellows I was competing against, they all started smaller than average. Whereas most of these guys now, they say, I could go into football, or I could go into wrestling, or I could go into bodybuilding. And so there's a really big, great potential to begin with. Much more better symmetry, better size, and so forth. So that's one of the reasons why they make much better progress. Or not, because of why they're so much bigger.
What fuels your passion for this sport even through today?
Well, it's different then than now. When I first saw Muscle Magazine, I was like 120 pounds, and it said, you two can have an arm like this. And I said, oh, my God, I can't believe it. And I took that thing home, and I had an old chinning bar, and I tore it down. And I said, I got to do those funny exercises. I'd never done it before in my life. And I started getting a pump. First time I'd ever had a pump. And I thought, oh, man, I can't believe what that feeling. And it got me so excited. I said, I just want to get up to average. That's all. And so I went back to high school. That was my senior year. And the girls started noticing me. You know, I said, oh, I got to do more of this. So because I was getting attention, it caused me to keep training more and more. Now as I'm 63 years of age, so now you're not doing so much for attention. You're doing more for health and for the way it makes you feel. And you're trying to learn. because now you have the competitor you have is age. Of course, before I was competing against him and him, now it's age is after you. And so you always got this competitor trying to find a way to offset age. And everyone else around you is losing to age. And so it makes you look better if you can just hold on to your own.
How great is it to still have the fans come up and want to be a part of your life, to share a part of their success that maybe you fuel?
That's real nice. The thing I like best now is that, and I didn't know this at all then, when you're so caught up in yourself, I'll give you an example. When I was competing for the Olympia, they took a shot with a gal on my shoulder. And I did not remember that. I said, they dubbed that in. And she came up to me the next year and she says, "Hi, Larry, how are you?" And I says, "Hi, how are you?" She says, "Remember when you took that shot with me on your shoulder?" I says, "We did?" I was so caught up with myself that I could not give attention to anybody else. And now when I come here, I can give to everybody and see people come and say, "Can I have your autograph?" And make them really feel good about it. Because, you know, when you meet your hero, you go home, the first thing you do is you tell the person what kind of a person they were. Like, for instance, you go see Cary Grant or something, you say, "I saw Cary Grant." Say, "What was he like?" "Oh, he's a nice guy." Or, "He's a jerk." And so you can... So you're the hero, and you can still be a nice person. And so it's nice to be able to go out and reinforce that image that they're carrying with them, just like I did. I mean, when I started, Steve Reeves was my hero, and George Eichmann, all these guys, and I get a chance to meet him. I can't believe this guy's really alive. And I sound like such an idiot when I was around him. But, so I know that feeling. I know that feeling really well of really being like a real hero worshiper.
Well, I can say that you seem like a really nice guy. Glad we got to meet.
Thank you.
Hey, speaking of Larry, I gotta have Larry Scott. Larry's an eloquent speaker, and he's one of he's been a great friend of mine since when we were youngsters. When Larry first won his Mr. Los Angeles and Mr. California title back in 1960, when I first met Larry, and he's been a champ ever since, on and off the stage. And I'm gonna let Larry say a few words. The great Larry Scott, Mr. Universe and first Mr. Olympia winner. And he conquered Sergio, too, by the way, twice. Once.
This is the greatest book that I have seen today.
Are they giving away free copies?
I don't know. Are you giving away free copies? I don't think so. But you want to pick this up. It's a wonderful book from Dave Greenberg. Okay, what are we talking about? Larry Scott's a name.
Been in this business for about
400 years, it seems. Really a pleasure to be here and see all these old friends that I haven't seen for so long. Matter of fact, when I got this invitation from, who was it sent that invitation? Anyway, Bill Comstock. I saw all the names of all those people that I've known over these years, like meeting Mickey Haggerty, that has been my hero for so long, and it's such a thrill to see guys like that you read about, and you finally get a chance to see them face to face. It's really a great pleasure. It's also just plain fun to be here with everybody you've competed with or watched as they've grown and progressed in their career, or not even competed with, just known them over these many years. And it's really a great thrill to just be here, like old home week. In terms of what am I doing today, I'm still in the fitness business. We've got our own, we have our own line of exercise equipment, our own line of health food supplements, and we've just released a new Bring Your Body to Life system that we're really excited about. It's for the average person, not the serious trainer. It's a pleasure to be here and to congratulate Joe on opening this world's gym headquarters. It's good to see him, and I want to say thanks to everybody. See you later.
Ladies and gentlemen, Larry Scott.
Would you like to go in front of you later?
I'm sure we'd like to hear a few words, or more than a few words, from Larry. So, ladies and gentlemen, Larry Scott.
Well, it gets heavy when you think of the things that I want to say. When I walked in this room, I have feelings I want to share before that, but when I walk in the room and I see the pictures I used to have on my ceiling in my basement, and I'd lay there and put my hands back over my head and look up at Bill Cronin and say, look at that guy. That is incredible. And I never had any hope ever of getting anywhere near. And I'm not suggesting that I have, but to be even considered in the same breath as someone like Bill Pearl and Steve Reeves and George Eichermann, I mean, just, that's incredible. As a matter of fact, I got to tell you a story about, I'd only been training for, maybe a year, and I must have weighed 150, and we heard that Steve Reeves and George Eichermann were coming to Salt Lake City. I lived in Pocatello, which is a little town about 3 hours north of Salt Lake City, and Steve Reeves and George Eichermann were coming to Pocatello. He said, "Oh, I'm in Salt Lake." I said, "Go, we gotta go see these guys." And so they were guest posing at the Mr. Rocky Mountain contest, and we drove up to Salt Lake because it was big stuff for us. I mean, we were just little kids, and we drove up there, and we were in there training in the health club, and Bob Del Monteith, who was staying there with, had come up to Salt Lake from Los Angeles with George and Steve was staying there. He says, he heard us going on about him. He said, "Oh, God, you're so great. I can't believe you're so wonderful." He said, "Would you like to meet him?" We says, "Me too." He said, "Come on, I'll take you over to the motel. You can meet him." And so we drove over around the block over to, on Main Street, and he took us in the motel, and Steve was laying there in the bed, hands behind his head, and you know, Steve always had for us magnificent calves, and George was shaving his back. Shouldn't have told you that one. But yeah, it was really informal. He went there, just like all the kids, you know, they come to me now, and they say, "I can't believe I'm seeing us." I know exactly how you feel. Exactly. I went through exactly the same thing with George and Steve when I was just starting, and the first thing I said was, "How do you get big?" And Steve looked over at George and smiled, and he said, "Marbles and dumbbells." And so, 2 years later, to be standing on the same stage with George Eichermann, the year he won Mr. Universe IFBB was the year I won the Mr. America, and to be standing next to him was just like, it seemed like any moment someone was going to come on and say, "What are you doing out here? Get off that stage." It just didn't seem like I belonged there. And I felt kind of the same way when I walked in here today. They'd say, "You know, this is a distinguished affair, sir. You're not supposed to be in here. Back to your room." It just doesn't seem like it's I guess you never do. You know, you're all you are is just a person. You know, it doesn't matter what you accomplish or anything, you're just a plain old just potato kid. And you never really become anything in your mind as far as, I guess there just really isn't anything special about a person. You just do some things you recognize for you. Not really anything special. And I noticed when we came up here from, we first got off the airplane, we walked into the terminal, and
it was real quiet.
You know, when you walk off the airplane in L.A., it's noisy. Everybody's talking, you know, loud, and all the Britons were whispering. And we all knew whispering. And so it seemed as if they were more reserved. You're more reserved. You allow me to say that?
You're due for an election.
And so I'm going to have to just, I can't be like you. I've got to just be me. So I want to get a little personal. I'll tell you a little personal story. And it goes something like this. When Malcolm has told you a little bit about some of my competing history, and, so I'm not going to go over that again. There were some wonderful moments, just absolutely wonderful moments. And I remember one time that I had won Mr. California, Mr. America, Mr. Universe, and I was training in a Big Tanny gym in Los Angeles. It was the middle of the day, there was nobody else in there. I was in there doing seated lat rolls. And this guy came up, it was a trainer, and says, "Hey, you got a pretty good build." And I said, "Thanks a lot." He says, "You ever think of competing?" And I said, and he says, "You ever competed in this?" Says, "Yeah, competed, Mr. California, Mr. America, Mr. University." Says, "You did?" I said,
"Yeah."
He said, "How'd you do?"
I said, "I won them all."
Now that's a true story. Yeah, those perfect squelches they talk about. Well, you know, years later, I competed in, I didn't compete. It was years later in about 1980. Rick Wayne said, "Larry," I was doing an interview for Muscle Fitness, "what was the highlight of your career? What was the main highlight? If I told you this." And I said, "Well, it was 1978. He says, 78. He says, "You won Olympia in 65 and 66. How could it be in 78? I said, "Well, I'll tell you." I said, right after I won Mr. Olympia, I was asked to give a guest posing in Los Angeles at the Mr. California. And after I was done guest posing, they said, "Could you say a few words?" And I said, "Right. And they gave me the mic, and all that noise went all over the place, and I was so shy and so unaccustomed to, I was accustomed to undressing, but not addressing. And I couldn't say anything. It just scared me so bad, I couldn't say anything. I just said, "Well, thanks a lot. And I sat down. And I'm telling Rick this story, okay? This is going to be several sequences back, so you have to stay with me. And I said, I couldn't say anything, Rick. I just couldn't say anything. And then after that time, just after I won Mr. Olympia, I had gotten reactivated in our church. And I realized that there was something more important in life than Larry Scott, that there was a much higher power than myself. And so in 1978, I was telling Rick this. In 1978, I got to guest pose the year that Luke Brigham won Mr. Universe, and after I was in guest posing, I said, could I speak to the audience? And I said, yeah, sure. Go ahead. And so this is what I told them. I said, all of the contests that I competed in, I need to tell you this, as a notice sign, they were all in New York City. And they're a great crowd. Well, just great crowds. They were fantastic. And I really had a loyal following them, but I never could tell them anything. I never could say, boy, I really appreciate you. You know, it is so great. I really appreciate it. Because I was too shy to do it. And there was just no occasion to it. So I said to them, this is a Madison Square Garden, about 3,500 people. I said, as I'm talking to you right now, and there was one person there, I said, I want each one of you to know how much I appreciate, really appreciate all the support that you've given me over all these years. And I've never had a chance to tell you that. And I want you to know how wonderful that was. That wherever I come out here, everybody's got wants an autograph and all that love I get from everybody. I said, that's a wonderful thing. It's just wonderful. And I've never been able to tell you that, but I said, I want you to know something else. That as great as that all was, as great as being Mr. Olympia was and getting all those autographs, it doesn't compare with the joy that I'm feeling right now, feeling myself supported by my Father in Heaven, and being able to speak to you as one person, as me speaking to one more person, because when I was trying to do it and glorify me, glorify Larry Scott, I couldn't do it. It was too frightening. But when I felt myself trying to glorify a higher power, a power that we all feel here, that feeling that you feel right now, that we're all one, and we're all participating in the same thing here, the feeling of brotherhood, that's a better feeling. That's a lot better feeling than the feeling of being the best of anything. And I want you to know that that's one of the greatest lessons I've learned. And it was such a wonderful thing to be able to stand in front of everybody and to be able to tell them that. And someone had asked me then, and so I said to Rick, and so that's why I'm saying in 1978, that was a better feeling. That was the highlight of my life. If someone asked me today, what was the highlight of your life? It wouldn't be 1978. And with all apologies, I can't say it would be tonight either. It was in the early 90s. During a time in which I lost two sons. And we learned some things that we could never have learned in success. The lessons we learned are well expressed in this little poem. It goes something like, I walked a mile with pleasure. She chattered all the way. She left me none the wiser for all she had to say. I walked a mile with sorrow, and ne'er a word said she. But all the things I learned from her when she was done with me. And we've learned some wonderful things. The loss of our boy. My daughter says, I have learned that you can bear anything. My wife says, I have learned that the most important thing is to love unconditionally. I've learned several things, and as I'm sure both Susan and Rachel have, two of those I'd like to share with you. One of them was I learned how kind God is. How kind He is. When you have a great deal of grief, of anguish, He says, I'll give you just a little. And I'll let you just feel that, and I'll hold the rest back. And when you've gotten through that, I'll give you a little bit more. Until you get rid of all of it. But I'll hold it back. And what a wonderful, kind thing He is. Another thing I learned was how He says, how much He loves us. How really much He loves us. looks out on all his children and he says, "Oh, I love them so much. I want to give them something they never had before. They never will again." And he gave us you. Because everybody here is so wonderfully unique. So gloriously special. And it seems as if there's just two things that we're on here on Earth for that we need to learn. If we just learn these two things, then we can bless everybody with the glory of our uniqueness, how special we are. And I think I probably would like to address this thought. Not to the people that are my age, because I think a lot of you are probably listening to me and saying, "I know that. I've lived a life. I know that." Maybe for the younger ones. I know it would have helped me if I had heard this when I was younger. A wise man said, there's two basic things you need to learn in life. One of them is, you need to learn how to repent. And the other one is, you just need to learn how to forgive. If you can learn those two things, you can bless us all. That's the things that I've learned. Thank you very much.
For the first time ever, the nine Mr. Olympias together on stage.
I just want to say a few words about Larry. He was the first Mr. Olympia. It was about at the end of 1964, we were eating at a Matador restaurant, and poor Larry was very unhappy. He just won the Mr. Universe and Mr. America titles and said, "What am I going to do now, Joe? There's no more other contests I can enter. Why should I retire so young?" So we said, "Well, Larry, we got to think of a title so we can keep all the champions in the game, because usually At that time, you can only win a title once. And usually the winners were very young and they haven't reached the peak of perfection. So we decided to have a contest to bring in all the champions and they can repeat and win as much as possible the event. So we sat down, we had to develop a title. So we said, "Well, what should we call it?" Now Larry and I, we were just having some beer at that time after our meal. And guess what we were drinking? Olympia beer. So we decided we'll call him Mr. Olympia. And he was really happy that he competed and he showed up, and he was a great champion.
You want to set this up so when it comes your turn, you can talk. Huh? Well, I got a lot to say. If you guys sit down, and I'll really take care of this.
Come on.
Well, in that short time, I don't know what I'm going to say except that...
Thank you very much, Larry.
It's your turn in a minute. It's a great honor, as you can imagine, to stand here next to all these champions and to be a part of them. I mean, there are no words. You can feel it yourself. To be able to see the champions of your sport and to be here at a night when they're all here together, and for me to be able to stand on the stage next to them, you can imagine the honor it is. And I want to pay special tribute to my friend Joe. I would not be even known in this industry if Joe hadn't have continually put my face in the magazines and supported me and helped me in advertising and so forth. And so I want him to know publicly in front of each one of you that he's been a great and loyal friend, and I really appreciate him.
Thank you.